debate to everyone. And I welcome everyone, ladies and gentlemen, our respectable speakers, to our program for today. So before we start, we'll start with the dua recitation by Brother Yazi Farhan.
Amin amin. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala asyrafil anbiya wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma innaka khalaqul azim, innaka sami'un alim, innaka ghafurur rahim, innaka rabbul arshil azim, innakal barrul jawadul karim. Allahumma afta' alayna hikmataka wa ansur alayna min khaza'in rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. ربنا اشرح لنا صدورنا ويسر لنا امورنا واحلل عقده من لساننا يفقهوا اقوالنا اللهم احينا بالايمان وامتنا بالايمان ودخلنا الجنه مع الايمان اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا ولوالدينا وارحمهم كما ربونا صغارا اللهم اختم لنا بحسن الخاتمه ولا تختم علينا يا الله بسوء الخاتمه ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل اللهم فينا ولا من يتبعون شقيا ولا مطرودا ولا محروما ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.
Thank you for Brother Yazi Farhan for such a beautiful recitation. So again, I bid a very warm welcome to our ladies and gentlemen, speakers and fellow listeners to our forum entitled Redefining Eating Disorders. This program, Redefining Eating Disorders, it was made possible with the collaboration between three great universities. We have Asian Medical Student Association, AMSA, from AMSA International Islamic University Malaysia, AMSA IIUM, and also AMSA from the Malaysian Allied Health Sciences Academy, AMSA MAHSA. And also, we also have KMBK UPM, which is the Club Mahasiswa Bimbingan and Counselling from UPM. So these three universities came together, and here we are able to create a great program entitled Redefining Eating Disorders. We are thankful that this program was a success, and hope for future collaboration with these three universities. So before we start, a few setups that I would like to explain is that regarding the program. What is this program for and what was its objective? So our program is entitled Redefining Eating Disorders. Among the main objectives of this program is to increase the community's awareness towards the various type of eating disorders present and the associated symptoms for early development of concern. Also to disseminate up-to-date information and best practices in the field of eating disorders. If you follow our social media, we have posted daily reminders regarding eating disorders and give some fun facts, and also raise consciousness and empathy for sufferers and decrease the stigma that eating disorders, that a lot of things are associated with eating disorders. And also in the form factor of the public, we also would like to guide participants on how to handle the diet in their daily life and create awareness to stay healthy, and also the need to exercise and not just rely on food intake. Other than this forum today, for your information, we also have a diet counseling session provided. This means that after this program, any one of you at home that's, you know, concerned or thinking about your diet, or you want to have a more regulated diet plan straight from a specialist in diet, we have dietitians, you can try to register in our diet counseling in the poster provided. We'll later pass it on again in the group, and you can also check our social media. So you just register with the link provided in our promotional posters or in our social media, either from AMSA IIUM, AMSA MAHSA, or from KMBK UPM, in order to join a diet counseling session. So if you want to regulate your diet or regulate your eating every day from a specialist, which are dietitians from the IIUM diet clinic, because we have a diet clinic, you can also register there after this program. So I, Ahmad Luman bin Muhammad Noor, will be your moderator for today's forum. So how will this forum look like? So this forum will be divided into two rounds, and each round will be held for 30 minutes with a break in between. So around 5 minutes after the 30 minutes, we'll have a break. So in each round, we'll be blasting questions to our two great speakers that I'll introduce momentarily regarding eating disorders and also as a suitable form factor for the public. We'll also be talking and delving into diet habits and practices and also healthy lifestyle. We believe all of these are highly important, especially in combating possible eating disorders or dietary problems that may come into in the future. Hence, before jumping into the discussion for today, I would like to introduce our panel for today's forum. So we have two great panels that are with us for today. So the first panel is Dr. Rozanizam Zakaria, originating from Negeri Sembilan. He has degree in medicine and MBBS from the University of Adelaide, Australia, and also master's and specialist training from psychiatry from USM. His current career is as a psychiatry specialist at Sultan Ahmad Shah Medical Center, more known as SASMAC, at IIUM Kuantan. He is assistant professor at the Faculty of Kulliyyah of Medicine at IIUM and also a fellow psychiatrist for children and adolescents under KKM, which is the Ministry of Health in Malaysia. As you can see, Dr. Rozanizam is spotlighted here with me. So there you go. He's also the Vice President of iMedic, Deputy Chairman at Kelab Kesihatan Mental Pahang. He's Advisor of Persatuan Ibu Bapa Anak Istimewa Pahang, also known as PIANIS. He is a committee member of Kumpulan Teknikal Pencegah Bunuh Diri Kebangsaan, which is a group dedicated to prevent suicide cases in Malaysia under the Ministry of Health Malaysia. Also an ambassador of Yayasan Ikhlas, and also has been authors of a few publications such as Solusi Stress, Psychology Si Kecil, Solusi Stress Under White Coat, Aku Nabi Isa Under PTS, Panduan Penjagaan Pesakit Dementia, which is a guide to taking care of dementia patients under University of Science Malaysia, USM. And also have also been invited in television as a panelist for in Astoria, TV Al-Hijra, in radio such as Sin FM, THR, Cool FM, Zion FM, Radio Pahang FM, and also Kelantan FM. He's also been invitational columnist in Berita Harian, Sina Harian, and Facebook Laman Minda. He's also an active mental health advocate on various social media platforms. You can check out on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube channel, Dr. Rozanizam Zakaria. We can see that our speaker is a very accomplished man today, with many achievements highlighting his career. Our second panelist for today is a panelist from UPM, Dr. Engku Mardiah, Engku Kamarudin, which is a senior lecturer at Department of Counselor Education and Counselling Psychology. She's also spotlighted here with me. So hi, Dr. Engku. She's currently teaching and conducting
hi,
research.
Lukman.
Hi, Dr. Conducting research and a student supervisor. The area of specialization is addiction counseling, mental health counseling, and crisis intervention. She's a registered counselor and senior lecturer with previous experiences, serves adults and children with mental health and multiple psychological issues in health settings with expertise in substance abuse counseling. I like to delve into a few details about Dr. Engku because she's also quite a performer in her career. She has a few publications. For example, she's been a panel for Tanya Sama Pakar. It's a portal under the Ministry of Health Malaysia. She's also an article writer for portal My Health under the Ministry of Health of Malaysia. And among her publications are about HIV and the stigma regarding HIV, and also support for families and NGO in the helping of drug addicts. Among modules of her publication is module Aku Nasihat, modul penilaian risiko, modul maknyah menurut perspektif Islam, modul psikopendidikan individu berasaskan teori kesedaran kendiri dan keazaman kendiri dan rawatan penagih dadah. So we can see that she's highly involved in drug addiction and helping people that have these problems under the Ministry of Health. There are also a lot of online articles publicized, for example, Ibangi Journal, and also indexed articles, for example, International Journal of Psychosocial Rehabilitation, Development and Psychometric Properties of Addiction Recovery Scale. Among her achievements is she is a paper presenter for the International Drug Prevention and Rehabilitation Conference, among many others. affiliation, for example, she's also affiliated with Perkamu International up to this day, Board of Counselors for Board of Counselors of Malaysia from 2007 to present, Incend Relief Humanitarian Malaysia from 2008 to present, International Society of Substance Use Professionals from 2018 to present, and Malaysia Criminological and Correctional 2020 to present. So there are actually more achievements if I wanted to talk about both of these speakers, but I'm sure all of you are more interested to start with our talk for today. I'm sure that these speakers are both great speakers that will later on will see their greatness when they give the speech. Hence, without further ado, let us start this forum with directing the first fundamental question. So as I said before, as this is a forum, we'll have 30 minutes and we have two rounds for this forum. So in each 30 minutes, I, as the moderator, Ahmad Lumain, I'll be asking questions to Dr. Rozanizam and Dr. Engku Mardiah regarding questions about eating disorders and also as a suitable form factor to the public. Also some questions regarding diet, healthy diet lifestyle, and how it can help you in the future. So we'll start our program now. I hope you guys are all ready, seeing as how you've been introduced to these great speakers. And we also have three universities joining us today. I'll start the forum. The first fundamental question that I would like to ask our first panel for today, Dr. Rozanizam. Before you start, you could say any words if you want, just before you answer the question. So the first question that I would like to ask to Dr. Rozanizam for today is, as we're talking about eating disorders, what are eating disorders actually? I'll invite Dr. Rozanizam.
All right, thank you so much. Can you all hear me well? Okay, all right. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat sejahtera. Thank you so much, Brother Lukman, for the kind introduction. My respected fellow panelists, Dr. Engku Mardiah, how are you? Thank you. Nice to see you today online.
This is Alhamdulillah. The first. Nice to meet you also.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think this is our first time.
Yes. That's great. Hopefully not the first and the last one.
Yeah.
thank you again for the organizing committees, AMSA IIUM, MAHSA, KMBK UPM for inviting me to be part of today's program. And I would like to express my appreciation and acknowledgement for all of you for the great work that you've done in creating this platform for us to talk about a specific problem, which is eating disorder, that many may not be familiar with, but I suppose still important aspect of mental health that we need to understand, because the only way for us to build more awareness and support for those who are suffering from mental illness is none other than increasing knowledge about what they are suffering and how we can help them as a society to be part of their recovery, recovery process. And today we'll be talking specifically about eating disorder. I believe there are many questions that need to be answered revolving around this topic, but let's just start with something a bit more fundamental and simple, which is what is the eating disorder itself. So as we know, eating disorder is an umbrella term, basically describing a specific form of mental disorder. As we know, mental health comes in various forms. It affects people's moods, thoughts, perceptions, behavior. But one particular example in eating disorder is an illness where it specifically affects people's emotions, attitudes and behaviors specifically surrounding food, eating habit, and the way these two interact in their life. So many would view eating disorder as those who refuse to eat, starve themselves until they become extremely thin. But eating disorder in essence is actually more than just that. People with eating disorder are suffering from various perspectives. One is, of course, from their behavioral perspective, the way they eat, the way they perceive food, and how food and eating affect their life. But underneath it, there are also issues surrounding emotions, where they suffer a lot with negative emotion, self-esteem issues, self-identity issues, self-image issues. They're struggling with a lot of negative thoughts that they have in mind that colors the way they perceive themselves people around them. They're suffering with a lot of comorbidities such as depression, anxiety, self-harm, suicide, substance abuse. But it all revolves around one thing, which is the way they perceive food in their life. So it comes in various forms. As we all know, we've heard about anorexia nervosa, one of the probably most spoken about eating disorder, bulimia nervosa, binge eating disorder. We'll talk more about this in a minute. But these are an example of eating disorders that are around. And there are not so many people that experience it, but there are people experience it. And one thing that we know about eating disorder is a lot of people who experience it, number one, may not realize that they've experienced it. And number two, only 10% of those who experience eating disorder eventually end up getting a proper help. Even though those with treatment, and majority of them will struggle to be persistent or consistent with the treatment that they receive. So all in all, it's a complex disorder affecting people's perception, behavior, emotions surrounding food and eating habit. It affects people in various aspects of life, but many of them suffering in silence. So that in essence, what eating disorders is all about. And that's why we need to talk more about it, open this specific can of worms, and so that we know what are we dealing with and how we can support those with eating disorders. We may not see them around us, but we know there are people around us. And even if you look up on media, there are various celebrities who open up about their problem with eating disorder. We talk about female celebrities, for example, Lady Gaga, Taylor Swift, Jessica Alba, Hilary Duff, and these are all celebrities who open up about their eating disorder problems. Not only female, you'll see male celebrities also experience problem. Elton John, Zayn Malik. These are an example of some celebrities who open up about their problems. But many more out there who are struggling in silence, as I highlighted it earlier on. So that's for a start, Brother Lukman.
Thank you for the answer, Dr. Rozanizam. It's especially interesting that it's becoming something that we need to raise awareness about upon. And I think what's interesting is that it often comes with comorbidities. Meaning if you have eating disorder, it often comes with, you know, stress, depression, which actually comes to our second question, which is to Dr. Engku. So before, so the second question is, Dr. Rozanizam touched upon how these eating disorders are behavioral, it can be to emotional problems, self-esteem problems. What other factors that could contribute to eating disorders?
All right. Thank you, Brother Lokman, for the such a question. So it's quite interesting. I mean, the introduction by Dr. Nizam just now, the overview of what is eating disorders. So I'm a bit short for me. I call it EDs. Is it okay with you? All right. Okay. What is the question is, what is the other factors that can contribute to the eating disorders? Okay, I think that's lots of contribution factors can lead to mental disorder or eating disorders. But I would say in this case, I will say that one of the factors is body dissatisfaction, or in other way, we are focusing on the people who have a low self-esteem, especially towards the physical appearance. So, okay, Brother Lukman, before I proceed with the explanation, okay, can you explain to me how you define pretty? Pretty, how do you define beautiful? How do you define handsome?
Thank you, Dr. Engku. That's an interesting question. So I'll answer it with my personal knowledge and how I see it. Mm-hmm. So how I define pretty, so I think I'll talk physically, lah. I won't go into personality, etc., etc. How I see well, pretty is someone who I see that, you know, they're very good on their eyes. And I think it is, honestly enough, it is affected by a lot of standards. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, I see this model, she's pretty. Or open social media. Social media and the society kind of defines what I see pretty is. Mm-hmm. So physically, I would say that pretty in my sense of, you know, just physical, is something that other people will say pretty too. But like, if you want to go into deep what beautiful is, and that's another story, lah.
I see.
pretty, something that I think other people will see pretty too, fair skin, etc., etc.
All right. Okay, that's cute. Because, okay, so you define pretty based on the eyes, isn't it? You mentioned that about the eyes, also on our physical appearance. So to be frank, actually, to define pretty is more than physical appearance. It's more on the your eyes, your ears, your nose, all those things. Actually, you can define pretty based on your own perspective. Some people say, okay, this is a quiet looking guy, but she's so kind, she's so generous, she's so soft-spoken. Then that's pretty for me. If you ask me pretty, I will tell them that my opinion, pretty is more than physical. It must come with a package. So in that case, if you define pretty based on the physical appearance, that will be the problem. Okay, then the problem will come up because your definition on pretty is solely based on the physical appearance. Then what happens is, if you have something in not condition or is something not meet your spec, then you become low self-esteem. That is the causing factor. I mean, the most probably factor that cause the low self-esteem among others, among teenagers, especially bila dia rasa when she look at someone else. That is what we want to highlight to the people, to the teenagers, to adolescents, to young adults, that pretty is more than that. So if you want to create something that you want to highlight your self-esteem, you want to increase your self-esteem, so please make sure that you are not looking at the single aspect. So this is the factors that contribute to the eating disorders, because these are the major factors, most of the factors that they are not satisfied their body happen, not satisfied the body, and then low self-esteem, and then there will be increasing numbers of eating disorders. That's another, that's one factor. The other factors which is can contribute to eating disorders is might probably because of psychological distress. For example, stress, burnout, academic burnout. Right? In your age, I think there were issues on academic burnout, isn't it? You're facing all stuff, all academic things with the exam. Are you finished your final exam yet? No.
Not yet.
Not yet. Another two weeks. Okay. Meaning that you will be having a stressful situation after this. Okay. So that's another contribution factor can lead to the eating disorder is stress and burnout. Then you are aware that when we have a stress or burnout, our body will release some hormone, for example, cortisol and ghrelin, yeah? Which is cortisol and ghrelin make you feel hungry and you want to take something sweet. And then during the stress also, they have issue on the emotional eating. Do you know that about the emotional eating? Emotional eating is something that you eat to suppress or to soothe your negative emotion. When you stress, you rasa burn out, then you are trying to use eating habit to make your feeling feel soothed and to suppress all the negative emotion. So this is quite dangerous because you are using the emotional eating as your coping skills when you are dealing with the stress. So in this case, you are trying to help people. We are trying to educate students. We are trying to help to educate our adults or our populations, our families. When you have a stress, you need to find something else. Adaptive skills. Not this is what we call maladaptive skill. Using something that can lead to other illness. Okay. Other than that, most probably because of what we call that the post-traumatic, the event you have, if you might probably experience post-traumatic is not something that experience by itself, might probably you heard or you read something that traumatized yourself, and then this would lead to you to use eating habit in appropriate way and finally will lead to the mental, to lead to the eating disorders. I think that was quite common factors that contribute to eating disorders for the time being now.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Engku, for the great answer. So two of the main points that she highlighted was firstly body dissatisfaction. Mm-hmm. And this is and we need a shift in having a perspective of what beautiful is. So that's quite interesting. And secondly, also talking about psychological distress, meaning when you're stressed, when you're depressed, find support in your family. So those are the two fundamental factors. So another interesting question that I would like to raise up from what Dr. Engku said is in terms of body dissatisfaction. The problem comes from us looking at people physically, whether we see them, oh, she's pretty, and that's why I like her, rather than her personality or rather than that person's kindness. So if it's okay with Dr. Rozanizam, I would like to ask, regarding body dissatisfaction, because you talked about how many celebrities talked about their eating disorders, etc. How do you think we can help people with body dissatisfaction because of the standards that are put on them on social media? Is that question okay?
Okay, thank you. So I agree with what Dr. Engku has highlighted with regards to the role of people's perceptions towards body image is one of the factors contributing to eating disorder. And this is probably one of the reasons why we see more eating disorder cases in Western cultures compared to Eastern cultures. And in fact, from clinical perspective, I myself do not see a lot of eating disorder cases in my population. So I've worked in Kuantan before as a psychiatry trainee, and then now in Kuantan. So we don't see a lot. There are cases, but not as many as probably what my fellow colleagues would have seen in probably in a more a bigger city like KL, for example. And if we compare this to maybe UK, US, we'll see a different in terms of prevalence. And one of the reasons is because of what influence our thoughts and our perspective about image, beauty standards is pretty much decided by our day-to-day experience. What we see in social media, what we see in TV, what we see in celebrities that we idolize. So that's probably one of the reasons why it happened in such way. And this makes me to one important point that I've pondered upon many times. And one of the things that I'm starting to get more worried is about the influence of more newer version of social media, like TikTok. So macam geng-geng saya ni, Dr. Engku ni tak berapa nak TikTok sangat. I don't know if Dr. Engku has her own TikTok account. But what I see in TikTok is, number one, people personify image a lot. They have filters that even can change people's image in a very, I suppose, in a very interesting way. And so they boleh buat muka bulat jadi tirus, boleh buat eyelashes yang tak ada jadi eyelashes. So it comes to the point where eventually we don't know what's real and what's not real anymore in life. And that's very interesting because majority of those who get involved with this kind of media is actually those who are, as what I was saying, we were talking about how social media influence one's perception about body image and whatnot. So this is one of the things that I've spoken about a lot, especially the influence of social media on younger generation, because those who are preoccupied with TikToks and even to some extent Instagram are those young actually coming from a younger generation, and whereby they are still in the process of building up their characters and personality, still finding tune what I want to be, how I want to be seen as, what kind of person I am. So getting exposed to this kind of unhealthy social standard actually would influence and how they grow up as a person. So that's why eating disorder, we would normally see happen around late teenagers. So during the transition period, maybe around 16, 17 onwards, kalau dekat Malaysia, we might see it a bit later, 18, 19 onwards, because that's when they started to ponder and struggling with the questions of about their own identity. So having social media in place on board would influence them in many ways. Peers is one of the other factors. Celebrities, bad influence from media are also factors that may influence this from body image perspective. So that's my comment on that topic.
Thank you, Dr. Rozanizam. Talking about how body disorders, they're highly influenced by social media because that's how we see and think how beauty is, rather than like Dr. Engku highlighted, personality and whatnot. Before I continue, I'm sorry again for all the disturbances happened. We also don't know how they came to be, but our committees are very hard now working in order to regulate the participants that enter and make sure that we have a safe journey and a safe talk at the end of the day. We hope you guys you can be patient, and we hope you can stay with us. So also a clarification: if you do have any questions, you can ask after the two rounds of this forum. So as we have two rounds, it probably extended by 5 minutes because of the disturbance. After these two rounds, we will open up to any questions. And if you have any questions, you can either verbally say them out later on, or you can type it in the chat box and I'll pass it on to any of the panels, either Dr. Rozanizam or Dr. Engku Mardiah. Okay, so I hope we'll continue. So Dr. Engku highlighted before about body disorders, and it's a great clarification talking about what do we mean by pretty. So it's highly important for all of us here, as much as we're influenced by the beauty standards and social media, the reality is, and a more long-term approach to this, is to see it in a better light, to see, you know, pretty is not just your looks, but it's more than that. So hence, I would like to ask the next question, and this next question is to Dr. Engku. Because Dr. Rozanizam also linked eating disorders and all of these problems to the personal problems that you have, for example, stress, depression, anxiety. So how does it work out? What's the direct or tangible link between anxiety and eating disorders?
Okay, thank you so much. For that question, Brother Lukman. Okay, anxiety. So what is the link? What is the association between the anxiety and eating disorders? Okay. Anxiety actually is quite common. It's something we all experience. So during your next week, another 2 weeks time, you will be passing a final examination. Most probably we will have anxiety. Those who don't have anxiety, there's something wrong with them. Right? Because this anxiety is quite common and something that we all experience. And basically, anxiety is normal and beneficial to us. Because when we are facing a stressful situation, the anxiety will come out, then it is a normal reaction. Okay. That's the problem is when the anxious feeling, when the anxiety feelings become unmanageable, then become excessive, which is then it would take over our ability to lead our normal life. And this is what we call the anxiety, the disturbance of anxiety into the eating disorders. Then those who have heavy anxiety and start using eating a non-good eating habit to overcome their anxiety. Okay, and then if you say you just I mentioned that before this there will be a comorbidities among eating disorders and anxiety. Yes, there are lots of cases which is ED also have anxiety disorder, and then most of the time anxiety disorders begin before eating disorders, and most of the time means anxiety start first and then followed by eating disorders. And then the most frequent associate with eating disorders is, for example, a compulsive OCD compulsive, OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder. We also have ED associated with social anxiety disorders and general anxiety disorder or PTSD. this is quite common comorbid between eating disorders and anxiety disorders. Okay, for let me give you one example. The link between the, for example, I think GAD, GAD, for example, those are individuals with GAD, general anxiety disorders. They often experience severe feelings and fear, and feeling, so they will feel restless and irritable, which is they tend to worry. And then what they do, if they want to reduce the worrying, then they start to eat. Start to eat and non-stop eating, for example, binge eating. So they will start to eat and eat without feeling hungry. Without feeling hungry, then they start to eat the binge eating. Might probably before, they also can have bulimia. They eat a lot and they feel guilty and then throwing back. They push or non-push, they will throw back all the food. This is quite common, which is they are using the food at the first place, they are using the food as eating habit. And at the end of the day, they start to have eating disorder, for example, binge eating and or bulimia. That is another link between anxiety disorders and eating disorders. So when we have two comorbid, so which one we want to tackle first? If you want to tackle anxiety first, or you want to tackle eating disorder, as a practitioner, normally we will see which cause first. Let's say eating disorders came after the anxiety, meaning that you need to overcome the anxiety first. You need to help the patient with anxiety, because we can predict those you have. Let's say if you focus on anxiety reducing, and the eating will reducing. If that the link between them. So that's why when you are talking about the management of patient with anxiety and eating disorder, you need to know what causing first, which cause why. That is another thing. So I think the association between anxiety and associate between anxiety and eating disorder is quite common. It's quite common among our patients. But as mentioned that Dr. Nizam, we have a very rare case here in Malaysia compared to Western country. So I think most probably our culture, we for Muslim, for example, we have been taught that you need to stop, kena berhenti sebelum kenyang, kan? I think that is a good nasihat, a good advice. You need to stop before you kenyang pun dah, then you kena berhenti, kan? You need to stop first, kan? I think that is our culture, our religious, that make her ataupun protect ourselves better. We are not talking that we are better than others, but in terms of eating disorders, we have our own culture restriction. We have our own religious restriction, which help us a lot in this situation. All right.
Thank you, Dr. Engku. Very interesting answer, and it's thankful that in the East, like Dr. Rozanizam also highlighted before, we don't have as much cases as eating disorders. And even if there are, for example, I've personally contacted some from SASMEC because of this program. SASMEC is a hospital near IIUM. Most of them have comorbidities, meaning they have major depressive disorder, for example, and they will have eating disorder. And it's also important to acknowledge which to tackle first. So regarding that, so we now understand the characteristics of an eating disorder. You probably would, there's comorbidities in it, and also the problem in social media and beauty standards that we touched upon. But let's say like we had a friend or someone we know that we think might have an eating disorder, or we want to help them. So a question to Dr. Rozanizam, how do we detect, what are the signs and symptoms if we see for eating disorders, and as an additional, what should we do to help them? Because as you also said before, more often than not, people with eating disorder, they stay silent about it. How do we help them in order for them to like find help for these? In addition with the question, how do we detect eating disorder?
Thank you, Brother Lukman, for the question. I think probably we'll start with highlighting some of the different types of eating disorder, so that we know they come in various forms, even though they are all under umbrella term of eating disorder, but it can come in various shape and forms. So there are quite a few eating disorders, different eating disorders, but I'll just highlight maybe two or three main examples, one for us to know different features of eating disorder. The first one, as we all probably have heard, is anorexia nervosa. Normally would be described as somebody who's extremely thin and have problem with intense fear of gaining weight. They involve in self-starvation behaviors such as avoiding food altogether, fasting longer than a normal expected healthy duration, and they have intense and extreme fear or anxiety related to anything to do with gaining weight. So that's anorexia nervosa. So for anorexia nervosa, normally we would have some ideas it happened because you can see it from physical appearance, especially at the later stage of the diagnosis. May not be so in the early stage of the disease, but normally somebody who experienced anorexia nervosa would have picked it up. Okay. So number two, bulimia nervosa. So it also have related. It is also a problem related to fear and anxiety regarding gaining weight, but there's a specific behavior related to it. Number one is binge eating, where they eat excessively at some point, and followed by compensatory behavior. So compensatory behavior where they do something in order to make up for the food that they've taken, right? To cancel it out. So for example, they involve in inducing self-inducing vomiting, or using laxative to induce defecation, or excessive exercise in order to make up for the amount of calories that they have taken. So contrary to anorexia nervosa, those with bulimia nervosa might not be as evident as those with anorexia nervosa. They might not be appear thin. They might appear just as any other regular fellow friends that we see, but they have these two components, binge eating and compensatory behavior. Another group is those who have problem with binge eating alone. So they lost control, so they eat almost obsessively, secretively or openly, to the point where they lost control, lost break of how they should control their eating. So these people normally would manifest with gaining weight problem like obesity, but they do not involve in compensatory behavior as bulimia nervosa. And another cluster or another group of eating disorder is something that is less common, but it's also known in a medical form, which is avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, or ARFID short form. So this is the extreme picky eater cluster or groups of people where they have a very specific repertoire or pattern of eating, or things that they're willing to eat to the point where it is pathological or problematic, the extreme picky eaters. So based on these characters or these different groups of disorder, so we might see changes that happen in people around us in many, many forms. So for example, we might see problems with preoccupation regarding gaining weight, for example. So they talk a lot about gaining weight. So you don't feel that they're gaining weight, but that's what they talk all about day in and day out. So preoccupation about body image, eating habit, and gaining weight. So that's probably one of the clues. Number two, avoidance with anything related to food. So they don't go out anymore. If they go out with you, they avoid eating, and you probably wonder, when was the last time I saw you eat? And because that's probably their regular habits and pattern. They avoid eating. So they might give you examples here and there, but might give you reasons here and there. But essentially, you see that, you know, this fellow avoid food by any chance, and so that's avoidance. Number three, probably you would see something more evident physically. So for example, excessive weight loss that you see, you see that they start experiencing physical symptoms like fainting, feel lethargic, paler ni apa, nampak pucat. So physical changes that you might see in people around you. And another thing that you might also sometimes notice is the excessive compensatory behavior that I mentioned about. So every time after eating, you'll find him or her go elsewhere. And so that's probably something that you might wonder. And for example, the self-vomiting, or you might hear your roommate, if it happened within your own close confidence. Or sometimes you might also see people who are exercising in an extreme form, like 4 hours, 5 hours, do not sleep at night, just exercising. And when you talk about it, it's not healthy anymore. It's not about becoming healthy, but it's about something. For example, the person has a specific target weight. For example, I want to be 45 kilos. I want to achieve 39 kilos, for example. So these are all the signs and symptoms that you might see with people who experience eating disorder, which probably should be an alarming signs for you to probably do something or talk about it with your friends, or even if it happened to yourself. So the next question with regards to what we need to do, of course, we need to make them realize that it is not normal. Those who experience eating disorder, most of them would probably start off with poor insight. They don't know what they do is wrong to begin with, and they persist doing so until it becomes part of their habits, part of their characters, personalities, or interests. And at some point, it becomes problematic. So those who are around these people and should be some sort of reminders, ataupun kita give them advice to some extent that what they are doing is probably excessive. Talk about it and see what they feel about it. Sometimes they do realize that it's a problem. So what we need to do is encourage them to get help. So this is the first step, I suppose. And I don't think eating disorder is something that should be tackled within peers, between peers. It needs to be tackled professionally because it's a serious disorder. It's an illness that needs to be treated. So our role is to support them in seeking help. And because it's not easy for them to coming out to other people about their problem, but we need to make sure that they do get necessary help that they need. So that's probably one of the main role that we can play as a society, I suppose. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rozanizam, for the great answer. So just to recap, so a few things that if you see your friend or someone that you know probably has this problem or someone that you should encourage to help. They could either be very thin, or they could be binge eating, or like a very important thing is they'll be talking about food or their intake or avoiding eating food day in and day out. If you see that, if you see that, ladies and gentlemen, it would be very advice for you to try and encourage them to help. So we're nearly done with our first round. Just the last question to Dr. Engku before we finish our first round, and then we'll have a 5-minute rest, and then we'll continue with our second round. We'll extend a little bit because of the disturbance, but by 12, we'll finish, I hope. So the last question to Dr. Engku before we have the rest between rounds is that an interesting point that Dr. Rozanizam brought up was people with bulimia nervosa or some people with eating disorders, they look normal, meaning BMI-wise or appearance-wise, they look normal. So I would like to expand on that idea a bit. So even if you have normal BMI, or for example, I'm thankful that I'm normal, even like someone like me, how would that person acquire eating disorders? And please elaborate more on how normal people can acquire eating disorders. BMI, thank you.
All right. Thank you, Brother Lukman. All right. Okay. Those are people abnormal BMI. I think eating disorder is something, a chronic mental illness, which is, it doesn't mean you have abnormal BMI, then you are not exposed to eating disorders. Then those are people who are having BMI also can expose to mental eating disorders. The issues here, it is more on the way you eat and the more on your way you perceive all those things. It doesn't reflect on your BMI. You have you can have a good BMI, but might probably you have a problem with, for example, bulimia nervosa, but the problem is the way you eat, the character which is explained. I think Dr. Nizam has explained detail on, for example, the bulimia nervosa. You can eat and then you push. You can eat, you push. This is something not normal. Okay, Brother Lukman, for example, Have you eaten this morning?
Apparently no? Not yet.
Not yet.
I should have breakfast.
You should have breakfast. You should have your breakfast because you need to switch on your metabolism. Without breakfast, the metabolism will not go. Okay. And then, but normally we as a normal person, we eat and then just keep quiet and then no longer keep quiet. We don't need to go to the toilet and push or everything. But those who are having eating disorders, this is happen to them. Because they have problem with, they disturb all the thinking process. They disturb their daily life, which is not common and it is not not good at all. So another thing is, for example, I'll give you example is might easy to understand. For example, bulimia. Okay, you eat and you try, you feel guilty and you purge, for example. When you push, there will be a risk there. There will be a risk there which you can choke. Huh? For example, you can choke all those things. Eh? And then what happened? There will be a risk on the fatal case. Risk to the fatal. So that's why I'm not saying that those are people who having normal BMI cannot have eating disorders. There are still tendency, there are still a risk for them. That's why in eating disorders, we need to know that there are it's a serious mental disorder because they can lead to the fatal case. Then a lot of cases which I write in the some journal which can lead to the fatal, for anorexia, nervosa, bulimia, all those things. So don't feel happy if you have a normal BMI. But you need to worry if you have normal BMI, but you have a weird or this. What we call that this disorder or something that something which is not correct, your eating habit, that is something you need to look in that. But it's okay. But anyway, congratulations because you have a good BMI.
Thank you very much. I did hard work on this.
kidding. Okay, that's good. Yeah, actually good BMI is good for you. It's good for us. Having a BMI means you are reducing the risk of other physical condition, other physical issues. Eh? Physical health issues. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Engku, for the great answer. And it's about your habit of eating and how you eat that's important. Your BMI doesn't become the most fundamental or equated in saying, oh, you have an eating disorder or not. So I hope all of us can take care of our eating habits in the future. And if you have a stable diet, that would be great. So I think that's all for the first round.
Okay, I just want to add more. It's not just like an eating habit, but it's more on the perspective, how you see yourself, all those things. Eating habit is one of the important characters to look into these issues.
Thank you, Dr. Engku. So I hope everyone can take into the multifactorial perspective of how eating disorder is. So I think that's all for the first round. So we'll have a rest in about 5 minutes. So it's about 10:57, around 11:02 or 11:03, we'll start again. So I hope everyone can stay safe and we'll see you again in about 5 minutes.
Whenever you want me, I need need somebody who can love me at my worst. No, I'm not perfect, but I hope you see my worth. Cause it's only you, nobody knew I put you first. And for you, girl, I swear I'd do the worst. Somebody who can love me at my worst. No, I'm not perfect, but I hope you see my worth. Cause it's only you, nobody knew I put you first. And for you, girl, I swear I'd do the worst. It's only you, nobody knew I put you first. And for you, girl, I swear I'd do the worst. Oh,
spend 24 hours anymore, I was real. You spent a weekend getting in. That when I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. Girls like you love funny, admit to that I want. When I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. That when I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. Girls like you love funny, admit to the hour. When I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah.
Okay, so hi everyone, and welcome back to Eating Disorders, Redefining Eating Disorders. So, I welcome again back Dr. Rozanizam and Dr. Engku Mardiah as to our panels for today. So now, continuing the event, we finished our first round. We've talked a lot about eating disorders, its characteristics, and we've touched upon many issues lately. We've talked about beauty standards, we've talked about the idea of pretty or the idea of beauty in society, and we've also talked about types of eating disorders and how you want to see someone with eating disorders. For example, if they have anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, and also one of a severe one is ARFID. So ARFID is characterized by fundamentally unwillingness to eat or avoidance of eating, and also talking about eating day in and day out. So now we'll continue our forum with a few more questions, and we'll cut it short because we don't have much time. But by 11:30 or 11:35, we'll open up questions, for the Q&A session. So if anyone wants to ask any questions, you can write them in chat later on at 11:35. So let's continue with the questions. And on this round, I'll start with Dr. Engku. So, Dr. Engku, so we've talked about eating disorders a lot, and a lot of these problems, and we talked about how severe and how problematic they are. So the question is, can eating disorder lead to multiple life-threatening conditions? Like, how severe does the severity goes?
Yeah, definitely. If you ask me the question, how eating disorder can lead to the life threatening? Yes, it is. You can see those are people who are having eating disorder. They are suffered a lot actually. They are suffered a lot probably because some of them are have a comorbid, and then there are problem on the digestion. There are problem with all those things. And yes, I think it is fair for me if I say that those are having eating disorders can lead to the pattern. This is something that the fact that shows that before the fact showing that it can bring to the pattern, especially on the anorexia bulimia. You can see from the statistics showing that anorexia bulimia can end up to the pattern. I'm not sure how many percent, but I think that was the one of the highest contribution factors that can lead to fatal in mental disorders. So this is very important to us to help these people, to help decide, to help them to overcome all those issues. If they have issue with the other issue on the MDD, let's say on the major depressive disorder, that is time for us to help our students, to help our family, our friends here, to make sure they go and seek for the help. Because if you have a person who are exposed to the fatal case, then it is time for us, it's our responsibility to make sure that they go and seek for the help. I think the most important thing you are using, might probably I will suggest here to use PFA, Dr. Nizam, yeah? PFA, look, listen, and link as a friend, as a team members, as a communities, you do need to look what happens around you. How is there any of your friends, any of your family members having problems with eating disorders? Based on Dr. Nizam just explained now, the criteria, the characteristic of eating disorders. And then look around, see is there any people need help? And then what? Listen to them. Listen to them, listen to their problems, be their eye, be a shoulder for them, and then try to link them to the practitioner, to a professional practitioner. I think Dr. Nizam has stressed out just a few times, this is complex mental disorder and need to be treated by a professional. So let them go, let them see the doctors, let them have a good proper treatment or intervention so that we can reduce or minimize the life-threatening event. And then because we don't want anyone from our friends or from our members to have those issues. I think this is answer from me.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Engku, for the great answer. So again, like, you know, we stressed again and again, always find help. And especially if you're scared of finding help, because that's normally the issue, well, that's something that needs to be proved upon. And if you have a friend, encourage them again and again to find help and continuously seek help, especially when having eating disorders. So then regarding that issue, another issue that I would like to touch upon is something that becomes of a more relatable form factor that the public would understand. So we've been talking about eating disorders, and as much as it's behavioral and mental and so on, it also touches upon diet. For example, you know, how we eat, our eating habits, other than, you know, other perspectives regarding mental and how you see these things. So in terms of diet, I would like to ask Dr. Rozanizam this question. How does what is a balanced diet, or you know, what would you like to advise people, a balanced diet that one should essentially take, like proteins and so on, in order to have a balanced diet? Like, that's a fundamental step in eating habits, I believe.
All right, thank you for the question. I'm not sure I'm the best person to answer this particular question. As a psychiatrist, I don't in particular do diet counseling. I suppose as a follow-up for this program, you have you would have input from dietitian. So they are probably the one who would be more suitable to answer specifically. But I'm just going to touch just a little bit on relationship between our eating pattern and our mental health. Even though we might not see it directly, but one of the fundamental things that would help us with our mental health is our self-care, our ability to look after ourselves. We might not realize it, but our eating pattern, sleeping pattern, exercise pattern, these are all factors that actually contribute a lot to our mental health. Exercise, for example, it looks simple. It looks like something that you might do 30 minutes, you walk from college to campus, you walk from classes to classes, but it actually does a lot to your mental health. For example, simple exercise release endorphin, release dopamine, which are neurochemicals in the brain that help with mental health aspects, your satisfaction, your mood, your concentration, your energy, your motivation to do things. So same goes to eating pattern. Always remember, whatever we eat, eventually we'll get to the rest of our body. It's not as simple as you eat, what comes in, comes out. Garbage in, garbage out, and some people say. It's not as simple as that, because essentially what we eat will get absorbed. Be it colouring, be it sweetener, be it whatever that we eat, will essentially get to our body. And one of the parts that it will touch is our brain. And remember, our brain is essential for our mental well-being. It regulates our emotion. So there's a specific part in our brain, our limbic lobe, the inner part of our brain, which regulates our emotion. So that's why sometimes we get irritable when we are hungry. We call it hangry. We become angry when we hunger, when we are hungry. That also explain why sometimes when we eat too much, we become unmotivated. We become very sloth-like and very sedentary. So that explains how our eating pattern influence our general well-being, including our mental well-being. For example, if those who experience stress earlier on, as Engku highlighted about stress eating, it also creates problems like you abandon healthy eating. And so to begin with, you're stressful, but because of feeling stressful, you abandon your self-care. And as a result of that, it affects your body to cope with further stress. And then eventually you fall into further trap of, for example, depression, and that is, which is something that is more severe. So it's almost like what we call like a quicksand. And where we get trapped, one problem creates another problem. And so look after our eating pattern, especially students. If you struggle financially, economically, do not resort to instant noodles. Talk to somebody. Talk to your students' affairs, dean, whatever, your society, to make sure that you get your basic needs as a human being. Because you need to study, you need to do extracurricular activities. You have your own family and friends for you to mix around. So you need to be healthy. And so do take care of your eating pattern. In terms of how much protein and fat and whatnot, so please join the program with the dietitian, or you can actually read up. There are a lot of resources talk about that. Saya takut cakap nanti salah pula.
Thank you, Dr. Rozanizam. So regarding instant noodles, I think if your students are listening to this, it's something common. Like, you know, I have friends, and all of us have friends that eat concert noodles commonly. And I like the term hangry. So when you're hungry, you're angry. So it becomes hangry. So that's a very interesting thing. So also actually another question to Dr. Rozanizam, because I found something interesting. So there were many factors for eating disorders. But however, I've also read that genetics could affect your eating disorder, meaning certain factors that you can't avoid because they're your genetics. Could you please expand on how genetics affect the condition of individual that have eating disorders? And how do these people, how are these people treated, or how do they cope with this?
Okay. As we know, all mental disorders, to some extent, are products of interaction between internal factors and external factors. So there's a genetic component. That means there are some features inherited, hereditary, and there are also environmental factors. So eating disorders are not any different from any other mental disorders. In fact, there are studies who looked into the prevalence of eating disorder in family members, find that 50% of those with eating disorder would have another family members, either primary or primary or secondary family members, who also experience eating disorder. So there are genetic influence. But up until now, we cannot exactly pinpoint the specific genetic link or specific gene responsible. All we know is, if you have a family member with eating disorder, you are more likely, to some extent, 2 to 3 times more likely to develop eating disorder. So it's important to look out for this. If it runs in the family, that means you are at higher risk. So as a general rule, do take early precaution and seek out help so that the key point with regards to genetic aspects of eating disorder.
Okay, thank you for the answer. So if we see any of our family members or anyone closely related to us by blood, they're eating disorders, there's a high probability. So as Dr. Rozanizam said, always have early prevention and seek out help early on if you see these signs around you. So now, I'd like to ask a question to Dr. Engku Mardiah, which is an important question, I believe, because we've talked about how severe eating disorders is, how it happens. But the question is, can eating disorders be cured? Or what are the effective treatments for people with eating disorders that are practiced by counselors and psychiatrists, such as Dr. Engku and Dr. Rozanizam and yourselves?
All right. So the question is, can eating disorders can be cured? I think, inshallah, the answer is yes. Eating disorders can be cured and can be treatable. And then it can treatable, something a treatable. So how can we help them? That is a quite very interesting question, because in eating disorder, they always come with comorbid. So people who have anxiety, like you say, you just check with the system, with the previous one, cases, that most of the cases is linked to the anxiety or major depressive disorders. So in this case, we need to know that, is there any possibility, is there any issue with the other mental illness, anxiety or MDD? So there will be a link or associate between them. So if you help them in terms of helping them with their stress thing, ask them how or told them or teach them how to do the coping skill, a good coping skills, and then in terms of that, we need also to have to treat eating disorder, you have to need a combination, a package. It's not like you can do solely counselors can do a therapy or counseling session with them. No, this must be a combination between professionals. So we should have a psychiatrist there, we should have a counselor there, we should have a psychologist there, we should have a nutritionist or dietitian there. Then, inshallah, I think it will be treatable and curable. So the method is to make sure our friends out there to go and seek for the help. Inshallah, with all those, the combination, the holistic approach, I think it will be easy to us to help them and to cure the AD's problem.
Thank you to Dr. Engku. So specifically regarding health, so what organizations in Malaysia that especially cater to this issue? I would like to ask Dr. Engku again.
Okay. Actually, we have MOH, I think, provide a lot of hospital and clinics. So if at any time you can go to any clinics or any government clinic, even though we also have a GPs or specialized on mental disorder, we have, I think, Alaminda clinic, we have Alaminda, and also other a few clinics here which is focusing on the mental disorders. Remember that eating disorders is one disorders under a mental health. So you can go and seek the treatment from our hospital, our clinic. If you go to the clinic, you go to the hospital, you can have a dietitian there, you can have a nutritionist there. That's, I think, the problem is might probably because they think that eating disorders is something biasa-biasa saja, nothing to worry. But actually, you have said just now, it can lead to the death. So that is important to advocate our friends out there, go and see the treatment and seek for the treatment. We have a clinic, we have also a clinic community, we have also Mentari clinic. There are lots of psychiatric clinic provided by the government and then non-government. We have also clinic psychology, counseling clinic. There's a lot of clinic provided in our country. Then just the matter might probably the awareness on eating disorder especially is might probably still not yet. So they are not still aware on the needs to have a treatment.
Oh. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Engku. Thank you, Dr. Engku, for the answer. So if you do have any problems, you can go to hospitals and clinics. You always have the specialist there. And another promotion, if you do think that your diet is at problem and it's the cause of why you have an unhealthy state, then you could also always join our diet counseling session later on in the program. Just click the link in our social media. We'll forward it into the participant group again and join the diet counseling session. So we can see that eating disorders can be cured, and there are certain effective treatments that need holistic cooperation and collaboration between psychiatrists, counselors, and many other parties. And you can find help for these eating disorders. So I think regarding eating disorders, we've talked a lot about eating disorders, and we've known a lot about eating disorders. And I think the participants, and I hope the participants are eager to ask more questions to the panels. So before we end, and I think that was the last question that I would like to ask the panels, before we end, I would like to open the floor for each panel to just give a few words of encouragement or a few words about anything that you would like to talk about eating disorders or any comorbidities, anything really. So I would like to firstly invite Dr. Rozanizam if you have anything to say regarding this topic.
All right. I believe most of participants in this session today are students. Maybe none of us here are in particular experiencing a specific eating disorder per se. But what we are hoping from today's session is we are able to understand that eating disorder may not be may not necessarily be as what it seems in the what we normally hear, like anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa. It may be started as simple as you having problem or issues with your self-image. It may start with a problem with you having doubts regarding your self-esteem. It may start with you about having problems about your personal appearance, and this is all how it all started. Okay, so remember, you don't have to wait until you come to the stage where you do develop the disorder itself, like we highlighted earlier on. So if you, at any point you think factors that we've discussed along this throughout this session today relates to you or people around you in some way, so my advice would be seek out for help, talk to people about it, reach out professional. So hopefully it doesn't get to the stage where it becomes as complex as what we discussed along the line of eating disorder. Because many of us might sometimes experience something that is not necessarily pathological. It's not a disorder itself, but it may started off with something as simple as stress. And but once we fail to cope with it, once we lost our ways to handle it, that's where it will start lead to a more serious mental health problems like depression, anxiety, and chronic self-harming behavior. And so maybe my important point is learning about how to cope with your problem with the stress, seeking out help, are also signs that we are a resilient person, and so do take the necessary measures in order to look after ourselves. So look after our self-care, self-compassion, create bonding, a good relationship with people around us, fellow students, get involved with healthy activities, have a healthy interest that preoccupy our time. So these are the things that actually will eventually add up to a healthy well-being for all of us, inshallah. So hopefully some of these points will relate you, even though we are not necessarily experiencing anything related to eating disorder, but at least that one or two points from this discussion will still benefit you in some way, inshallah. Thank you, Madhul Luman.
Thank you, Dr. Rozanizam. So I hope you all can take in the advices that he gave and practice in our daily life. Now we'll continue with any words of encouragement or anything really from Dr. Engku.
All right, thank you, Lukman, Brother Lukman. In UI, they call it brother, to address brother and sister. Brother and sisters. Okay, I think for the foremost, I would like to congratulate to the team members, to the organizer for such having this area to be discussed in the channel, in this platform. How would I to say? Actually, I do agree with what Dr. Nizam said just now. Instead of you as adolescents, young adults, for example, I think most of our friends here are young adults. So it is important to know yourself. I mean, to know and put the standards to yourself, not with others. You yourself put the standard to yourself. Don't influence, don't terpengaruh lah by the other media, social, all those things. Because you need to put the standards based apa yang you rasa perlu, based on your needs, based on what you think is need for you, not other people needs. So these is other things you need to have. Definitely you need to have a good exercise. You need to have a good eating, but remember that not too much and not too little. So everything you do must be in between too much and too little. If too much and this too little, there will be issues will lead you to the mental disorders. So as a human being, you do just in between, just nice. Not too aggressive, not too little. So these is other things yang you have to need to know and you need to understand. And then those are people who are having stress. I think stress is common reaction. The most important is how do you cope with your stressful situations? How do you manage your stressful reactions? And how do you have a good, what we call that, coping skill? Do you have a good adaptive skill? This is important. Because if you do more than that, there will be some issues on maladaptive. Because most of the cases which lead to the other mental illness or lead to the mental illness because of the maladaptive behavior. If you have stress, don't eat too much. Remember that, don't eat too much. You can eat, but don't eat too much. Or don't eat too little, but just nice. That is very important. And then you need also to have to know how to overcome your distress or your stress issues or your issues with a good coping skills. And then you need to have also a resilience skills. Nowadays there were lots of challenges outside there. Even though you have in the screen just now, even though we just set the screen just now, we can see the, all the challenges come in. See? So you need to have your own resilience. Resilient, build up your own resilience. So if that the case, if you have a good resilience, inshallah, it will prevent you to have all those things. Tetapi kalau dah nak, kalau dah kata, let's say you have all those things and it's happened to you again, then no problem. We still have a good treatment. We still have a good apa ni, professional out there will help you. Don't worry, inshallah. Just hidup ni kena ada in between lah. And don't too much and then too little. That, I think that's all from me. So I wish you all the best and good luck, and hoping that we are in the good situations. We can, inshallah, our especially in Malaysia, kan, we can have a good relationship with others. That's all from me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Engku and Dr. Rozanizam, for their wise words and highlighting what Dr. Engku said. I think there were two biggest points that she did. Firstly, a moderation in everything you do, especially in eating. Don't eat too much, don't eat too less, and you have some restraint. So we'll go to Muhammad Ashraf's question. There's already questions. And then secondly, talking about beauty standards. So there's actually a quote that I would like to quote. A lot of people, you know, you have beauty standards and you think you're not pretty enough, either for yourself or for other people to see. But there's an interesting quote that I found on Instagram, social media. The quote was, "The flower does not call for the bee. It just blooms and the bee comes." It means that just do the best in whatever you're in. For example, studying, just be the best person that you can be. And later on, people will come if you're finding someone. Or if not, later on, people will see your beauty regardless. Because especially as an adolescent or young adult, we do focus on looks a lot and appearances. But I believe later on when we grow up, a bigger quality for a long-term relationship would be your personality and how you act towards others, which I believe is especially important. So now we will continue this session with the Q&A session. So we already have one question from Dr. Muhammad Ashraf. I'll read it out. I have a question. Maybe both doctors can answer it. I usually eat more during stress, especially during exam week, stress eating. I cope it by eating, as I think if I need to go out for a walk or away from my room, it will be a waste. It will waste more time besides studying. So how can this be corrected, doctor? So any doctor that wants to start first, Rozanizam or Dr. Engku?
This certainly brings some memories of my student years, I suppose. When I was undergraduate, as a medical student, I do better in Adelaide, Australia. And during exam, normally in the middle of the year. So back in Australia, middle of the year too, it's winter. So memang we studied in sleeping bag in front of the heater and makan all the time. Because winter ni kita lapar semua. Memang lapar saja. So kat Malaysia, I don't know how it relates. Tapi of course, As we discussed earlier on, stress eating is a real thing. People can resort to that sort of thing. But I suppose one thing that we need to always remind ourselves is quantity does not always translate to quality. Apa maksudnya? We might think that study straight away for 10 hours is a good thing because we have 10 hours on us quantitatively. But the truth is, we might not actually be able to concentrate and memorize everything that we learn for that 10 hours. And so we might fall into the trap of believing the longer we study, the more we gain. It might not be true. I'm not saying that you have to shorten the time of your study. That's not the point. My point is, sometimes we need breaks. So that's what we need. Because our concentration, our sustained memory does not last that long. And so do you know, Lukman, how long can we sustain our attention?
Around 45 minutes.
Around 45 minutes. I deal with a lot of students and patients with attention deficit disorder. So they struggle with attention. This is the question that I commonly ask people that who do not have attention and deficit problem. We actually can only sustain our attention, our age times 1.5. So let's say for easier calculation, you're 20 years old. So you can actually sustain a full attention at one given time, roughly around 30 minutes, right? So after 30 minutes, your concentration will start coming off. You'll start derail. Okay? So what does it mean? I'm not saying that you need to study only for 30 minutes, but what I'm saying is after 30 minutes, actually you'll start losing your concentration. So you need to do something to recharge your concentration. So sometimes a thing as simple as going for a walk, taking a deep breath, doing a simple mindfulness, having a small chat with your friends. These are the things that will help us to regain our attention. Then you come back to that 30-minute stage. Then you go back to that 30 minutes. So do a small a small chunk of study time instead of study straight away 10 hours. So understanding that concept, then you understand why it is actually nothing wrong by having a break to maybe do a small exercise for 15, 20 minutes, going out to your friend's place or that does not disturb your studies in the long term. In fact, it does good because you regain your concentration, provided that you come back to your work, to what you studied earlier on. Lah. Jangan you pergi 20 minutes and then melilau, and 3 hours baru come back, then that defeats the purpose. Lah. So hopefully that answer why I think you should not see having a small break, doing a small things in between the study as something that is counterproductive. Hopefully that answers.
Dr. Engku,
I think Dr. Nizam has elaborated in detail on that situations. Kan? Some information. Okay, during your stress, normally you will produce a hormone, cortisol hormone and ghrelin hormone. Cortisol combine the ghrelin, desire to have sweet things and feeling hungry, which is at the end of the day you will find those things. You akan cari benda manis. You akan try to get all those things, Starbucks lah, apalah, tea life lah, all those things. Yeah? Okay. Which is, that is the thing that you need to aware about yourself. Huh? This is the thing that the combination of the hormone can then trigger you to have a lot of things. But the thing, what you need to do is the control of the thing. Dr. Nizam has suggested that you need to do another alternative. It's not the eating all the time. It's not eating. Yes. There will be a term we call it emotional eating, meaning that you are using eating to suppress or to soothe your negative emotion due to stress. That will be we call it. But you need to alternate it with other activities. You cannot use eating as your coping mechanism. You need to try to have a walk after 20 minutes. I remember that I got one case study on the marijuana cases, which is I think the maximum of concentration is 20 minutes. But I found that myself, I always have 20 minutes concentration as well. So every 20 minutes, 30 minutes, do something else besides eating. You might go and walking, you might chat with your friends, or you might but don't handphone. Yeah? Handphone will drag you to another world. Please keep handphone. But you can eat, you can go something else. Doing something and go to another room, just put yourself something, do your like other activities, but do not proceed with the one activities. Like for example, you are talking about eating, yeah? You just not eat all the time. Stress eat. If you have a lot of stress, lots of eating happen. So there will be an issue after that. So you need to remember that. To cope with the stress, it's not one simple thing. It's not one one activity. There's lots of activities. There's lots of coping skills can be done to overcome our stress. I think with answer, I think we'll cover lah, both we'll cover and be just additional on top up to Dr. Nizam just said just now.
Thank you, Dr. Engku. So the 2 points that I guess were highlighted by both Dr. Engku and Dr. Rozanizam. Was firstly, be attentive to how long you can study. So study in intervals, like Dr. Rozanizam, Dr. Engku said, because our attention span isn't as long as we think. And so secondly, substitute eating with something else, probably an activity. And I think one of the biggest problems that Ashraf had was, you were lazy or you were scared that it will waste your time if you go somewhere else. But I think that's exactly the idea of studying. For me personally, it is about control. Like either you want it or not, it's about how you control what you do. Like laziness does come. But as much as people can give advices, control and our self-restraint, I think, is especially important. Because that's actually just it at the end of the day. And also other factors that can help. So, thank you for the answers. Now, continuing with the second question from Shahira. I'll read it out. Doctor, if we see our friend who is so thin, but when asked, they denied it. They deny that they have eating problem. But I noticed that he loved to throw out the food again and again after eating. So how can we help these people that are in denial, seemingly? So any doctor would like to answer this question?
Okay, this is probably number one. Thin does not equal to having eating disorder. I was thin myself. Masa dulu-dulu dah, zaman dulu-dulu. Zaman sekarang tak berapa lah. Throwing out food pun juga kan. Ada orang yang memang maybe bit picky itu ataupun tak berapa selesa dengan certain food. Tapi if whatever yang you say itu accompanied with other signs and symptoms yang kita highlighted earlier on dalam kita punya discussion earlier on tadi, then maybe it's about time to talk about it openly with your friend. But mind you that it is not our role as a friend to change them as a person because it's beyond our capacity. So what we probably need to do is probably just increasing his or her awareness about what constitutes a problem so that he or she might be able to reflect upon themselves and see whether any of the problems that we talk about relate to them. And if at any point they are willing or see that they need to get help, then that's probably where we could possibly lend support for them to say that it's nothing wrong in seeking out help from professionals or seeing somebody or talking about it. Or if they're not sure whether what their experience is, then even if not, talk to somebody. Maybe go to see a counselor to begin with in university level. Or even outside clinic kesihatan, and they can do further screening from there. Sometimes it might not be eating disorder. It may be related to mood problem, for example. Somebody who's depressed might not have the appetite to eat. And so that also need help in some way. Or maybe it's just a simple stress. And so talk about it, support them, encourage help. So that's probably where our boundaries with regards to what we can do as a person in this situation.
Dr. Engku, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, I think this is quite common. I think lots of questions been asked. If you have mental disorders, any mental disorders, what should we do as a friend? What should we do? We see it happen around us. And what we should do? I mean, the most important thing as a friend, being support to them. Being a listener to them because it is your friends, so it happened. It's your friend, and it is. I mean, it is good to have a good listener there. It is good to have a people around us who are taking care of us, because we are like a sister, you know, brothers and sister in IIUM, eh? Sister and brother, brotherhood. Eh? So, in terms of that spirit, so just being a listener to them, listen to their problems. Just tell them, if you need any help, then I will be there for you. I will be there for you. And then if you can persuade them to go and seek for the help for the treatment, then that's good. But for the beginning, I think as a friend, what you have done now is being there for them. You just being there for them. If you and got anything problem, you can come to me and you can discuss with me. Then we try to our best to find way how to we can help you. I think that is very important in this situation.
So I hope we can be good listeners to our friends, and as highlighted by Dr. Engku and also highlighted by Dr. Rozanizam, as much as our efforts can go, at the end of the day, we have no power to change them. We just can help them the best as we can. So that's what we should do. So also an important notice, please fill in the feedback form as given in the chat. So this is highly important so that we can get some feedback regarding how our program is done and how we can improve it in the future. Okay, now continuing with the next question by one of our committee members. Doctor, why does it happen that after working out and following a diet for around 1 or 2 weeks, when we see no results, we go back to an unhealthy diet and a sedentary lifestyle? Sometimes even stop eating for the whole day because of self-perceived hatred towards the body. Is there any way to recover from a negative body image? So, any response?
Okay. All right. That quite interesting story. Interesting question. So they are talking about the diet. I think they are looking for, I do not know what is the motive or what is the objective of this diet. But I believe that what they are trying to reduce the weight. They are trying to reduce the weight because if anything that you want to do, you need to know what is the objective. Why you do this? If you are looking for something that a good habit, I think that what should not be a problem. But if you're looking something nak cepat, mesti settle in within 2 weeks time, might probably there's something wrong with your objective. Because doing all those things, doing all the diet thing, you need to know the specific reason. Just because you want to just go slim or you want to have a healthy, to have a good or healthy lifestyle or to have a healthy body. The understand well what you want to achieve. If you do not know what is actually what you want to achieve, this is something happen after 2 weeks, then you still it's not working anymore. Or I just want to go back to what I do after before this. This is what happened. To sustain, for first thing you need to know exactly what do you want to achieve and how all those things beneficial to you. And second thing is to sustain the motivation. Because at 2 weeks time and then you go back to your daily routine, this is quite common problem. You have lacking of motivation there. Because bila kita nak, we are trying to have all those things, you remember that this is not an easy task to do. That needs a lot of motivation. That's why I always stress out. If you need to do something, make it properly. You need to have a very clear picture on what you want to do. All right. I think that's well, the reflection on this question. It's my reflection on this question.
Rozanizam, anything to add?
I'm good.
Okay. Thank you. So 2 points highlighted by Dr. Engku. Firstly, have a clear objective. And secondly, you have to sustain your motivation. I myself personally, just as a moderator, I've been through a few types of diet. I've tried keto diet, intermittent fasting. And honestly, nothing really works for me, which is saddenly enough. But some things do work for me. For example, workouts. So I'll just like to share what I personally do. So it's harping upon those two things, clear objective and sustaining motivation. For me, I never start something drastically because I remember I was once trying to, you know, I wanted, okay, in 3 months, I want this type of body. So I did like drastic, heavy workouts. It didn't work at the end of the day. After 1 or 2 weeks, I was tired. But what did work was something that I started bit by bit. So I started to do push-ups every day. I used to be like quite weak when I was in Form 1, Form 2. So every day I did 10 push-ups, nothing more. And by a year, I was already up to 50 push-ups a day. So I think how you want to start something, any regime, a diet, a workout, always start bit by bit. If you do a drastic change, more often than not, it gives too big of a change to your lifestyle that's hard to cope. And how I sustain motivation, normally there's two, either my friends, I normally jog with my friend, that's how I keep jogging every day. Or if you don't have friends that are, you know, helpable enough, I always find movies or other things as a source of motivation. But yeah, it's basically just hopping onto those two ideas. Have a clear objective. Don't rush it. And also sustain your motivation in a plethora of ways. So that was the most recent question from Tarin. So does anyone else have any questions that we would like to ask our two great panels here today? If you can't type it, it's also permissible for you to use or verbal if you want to say it out loud. So I believe I'll just give around 4 minutes for anyone. If you're typing out, I'll give you time, etc. If not, we'll come to a conclusion. Okay, so I don't think there'll be any questions left. And alhamdulillah, we've managed to finish before 12 as promised. So before we end, I would like to ask if the participants, the committees, and everyone in this meeting to open your camera and pose. We're going to have a little taking picture session. I hope everyone in the meeting can open your camera for a moment. The picture will be captured by Roshvin, one of our committee from MAHSA. So I believe Roshvin, you can start the countdown and everything for the picture.
Yeah, I'll just wait for 1 minute and then I'll start with the countdown. Okay, I think we can take the picture. So in the count of three, two, one. Okay, and freestyle. Three, two, one. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Roshvin, for the picture session. So as everything is done, we've asked questions, we've been educated about eating disorders. I hope everyone here and everyone here that came to this program can also pass this on to the people that you know, your family and friends, raise awareness about eating disorders, and more importantly, take care of yourself and see if you have any symptoms, you have any signs, only seek help. Seeking help is not a weakness. It's normal for people to have problems, but what's important is that we realize our problems and we're there to find help. So that's all. And a big thanks and thank you to two of our great speakers, Dr. Rozanizam and Dr. Engku Mardiah, for spending their time, especially in the morning today. We're really thankful for all your guide and your tips. And we hope to see you again in future programs. So that's all from me. Thank you, everyone. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. The committee can stay.
Before we end, could everyone just like fill up the feedback form? It'd be really great.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.